Bonjour, mon nom est Michel Poirier, je suis le directeur de développement des affaires chez Solotech. Bienvenue à notre webinaire hebdomadaire. Aujourd'hui, la première de deux parties de produits très intéressants de ChromaKey, présenté par M. Paul Pelletier, qui est Brand Manager pour ChromaKey. ChromaKey, c'est une compagnie canadienne. Paul est basé à Montréal comme moi. Et exceptionnellement, on va faire ça très canadien, très bilingue. La période des questions, l'introduction que je fais présentement est en français. La présentation, elle, est en anglais. Et si vous n'êtes pas familier avec la formule, eh bien, on commence avec l'introduction, suivie de la présentation de Paul, qui va se finir par une période des questions. On vous demande de poser vos questions par écrit dans la section des questions. Ça va nous faire un plaisir d'y répondre. Et si jamais on n'avait pas le temps d'y répondre, parce qu'on essaie de garder ça en dedans de 30 minutes, eh bien, quelqu'un de notre équipe va se faire un plaisir, avec l'aide de Paul, de bien répondre à votre question. Donc, encore une fois, je vous présente Paul Pelletier de ChromaKey, qui va nous parler des LED ou des Dell et comment ChromaKey, une compagnie canadienne qui utilise les LED pour faire de l'éclairage, qui est quand même assez spectaculaire. Monsieur Pelletier, à vous.
Merci. Merci, Michel. Donc, bonjour à tous. Hi, everyone, and welcome to this ChromaKey webinar. So, before we start, just a few words about ChromaKey. So, ChromaKey is a leading brand of professional LED products. We started nearly 25 years ago now by first doing color scrollers. Just over 16 years ago, ChromaKey introduced its first LED products, the ColorBlock, which has since been followed by dozens of other innovative product families like the ColorForce, StudioForce, SpaceForce, Inspire, and a few years ago, the acquisition of Vista Lighting Control System. ChromaKey products are designed, engineered, and manufactured in Canada, and of course, this is something we're really proud of. Our goal at ChromaKey is to provide our customers and users with brilliant solutions. So with that said, let's move on with today's topic. We're going to talk about white light made with LEDs. So, but first, what is white light? So it's a term that we use broadly in this industry, but this is white, so is this as well. So we need to define this white, so there's a different options there, let's say. So another way to look at it is from a real life application. This is a warm white. This is what we would call a daylight white, and this will be a cold white. To this, basically, we call that with color temperature, and we give them numbers like 3,000, 5,600, 6,500 Kelvin. But how did this number came about? Where we decided to use a temperature to call these different white? Well, color temperature is defined by a light source at a temperature of an ideal blackbody radiator that is heated up to a temperature that is, we would say, looks like a color temperature. So that's how it was defined. So we call it correlated color temperature, or CCT, and we express it in Kelvin, and we use the K as the symbol. So the word correlated is important here. It means basically that something that looks like. So it looks like a temperature, something that would be heated up at 6,000 degree or 3,200 degree, for example. So correlated color temperature is basically what we see here on that line right here. So all the colors will be lined up on that line. We also see the same here. So this is called the blackbody curve or the Plankian. And what we see here from up and down, these are all the same color temperature, but will have a different color shift. So plus minus green, you probably heard that before. Above it is plus green, below the line is minus green. Now, still talking about different white sources. So if we look at the spectral power distribution of an halogen lamp, that's what it looks like. On the left, we have the blue. On the right, we have the red. Being an halogen lamp, there's more red than there will be blue. If we look at a compact fluorescent, for example, this is how it's going to look like. So different peaks generated by the gas, but the average of this makes some kind of white. This is a Nature My bulb. This is a warm white LED. And this is a cold white LED. And if I put all of these on top of each other, they all look different, but they all produce what we call white light. Another way to produce white light is using colored LED. So in this case here, we had red, green, and blue. And by combining them at the right intensity, we will get some kind of white. Now, if we want to get a better white, we can add amber to the mix as a fourth color. And as you see here, it is sitting right between the green and the red, and it's filling up the gap there. So that will be helping tremendously the look of the white. Of course, we could stretch this. We could go all the way to a system with eight colors. So it will probably give a better white. But of course, it will be more difficult to manufacture, more costly, and also a lot more difficult to calibrate to get the same fixture one after the other. So again, let's look at some other white source. This is a white LED. So, and in this case, a cold white. We see there's a blue peak there that is quite high. And that's because it is more on the blue side than it is on the red side. While a warm white LED will be more on the red side. But as you can see, there's still a little peak here. There's a high peak for the blue. And there's still a small one here. Just remember that. We're going to use it later on. So far I've talked about white, and every time I mention white LEDs, I did put the white in bracket. So why is that? Well, what if I told you that there is no such thing as white LED? It does not exist. So indeed, through this presentation, I'll tell you the truth, the whole truth, nothing else but the truth about white LEDs. So white LEDs, so what is the problem then? Well, LEDs produce single color, like red, green, blue. So natively, an LED cannot produce white light. So how do we solve this? Well, if you remember back in the days, fluorescence tube were basically using, well, still used today actually, but fluorescent tube will basically create white light by using a UV light created by a current going through the mercury vapor. And then this will excite phosphor on the coating of the tubes, and this phosphor will glow through phosphorescence. So a white LED works more or less on the same principle. It's basically a blue LED with a phosphor coating on top of it, and that will generate a white. The different phosphor put on that LED will generate different color temperature or even colors. So how does this work now? Well, it starts with a phosphor material, like in this case, YAG-C or C-dope, yttrium, aluminium, garnet phosphor. Yeah, that's a mouthful, but that's the name. And then we have a blue LED that will emit photon. So a photon will enter into the phosphor molecule and will push one of the electrons to a higher orbit. And by doing so, this electron that is now in the higher orbit will try to stay there and won't be able to sustain that higher energy. And so it will jump back to its original position. And by doing so, it will knock out the photon. So now that the photon is being kicked out of the atoms, it will lose energy. And on this process of losing energy, it will start emitting a longer wavelength, so warmer. And therefore, this is how the warm white will come out of this process. So there you have it. That's how white is being created out of the blue LED. Okay, so now we know how to create the white light from blue LEDs. Great, so we're ready and we can start manufacturing fixtures, right? Well, not so fast. Have you ever heard about LED binning? Well, when LEDs are manufactured, in theory, they will be all the same. But through the process, there's some variance happening. And when a wafer comes out with all the LEDs on it and they separate the LEDs, these LEDs have slightly different color temperature. So what the manufacturer will do, well, they will start binning them. They will bin them on usually two variables. One is the wavelength, the dominant wavelength, and the other one will be the intensity. So then the tighter the bins, the brighter the bins, and the higher demand for the bin, the more money those LED will cost. So that's how it works. Okay, so now we know about binning. So What do we order? Well, that's another headache. So if you're, let's say you're designing LED fixtures, but to light up driveways, well, the importance of color temperature and color shift is not that great. Your neighbor will probably not come over to your house and say, hey, your driveway is slightly greenish. Can you do something about it? So these manufacturers actually will buy the cheapest bins they can, and they will not care about the accuracy of those LEDs. As long as they emit enough light, they will be perfectly fine with this. The next time they place an order, it will probably be a completely different set of bin. Nobody will ever know. In the low-end market for fixture in our industry, well, then they will go a step further. They will try to order a batch from a single bin or nearby bins, and then we'll build a batch of fixture. But the next time, they will probably buy a different bins. So the fixture from, although they look the same in the same batch, they from batch to batch, they will look slightly different. And you probably have seen that with video panel. It's a good example. So, but for real professional products, like of course, like what we do here at ChromaQ, we will go for a single tighter bins. And we always buy from the same bin, and time after time, and of course the cost will go up, so does the quality of light. But even there, if we buy from a single bin, there's still some small variants. So when we receive the LEDs, we will push this a bit further, we will remeasure all the LEDs and rebin them again. And when we build the products, we will make sure to average this so that all the products get the same white point. So we have this process called ColorSure, and this is basically how we do it. We guarantee that within the same product family, all the products will have the same color, and even if you buy it at different times. So great. So far we've seen the LEDs we've seen were LEDs with, they were blue, and they had this phosphor coating on top of it, and that's how they created their white light. But there is another type of fixture called remote phosphor. As the name says, in remote phosphor, the phosphor is put remote or away from the blue source or the blue pump. You will hear that term as well. So remote phosphor has the advantage of being 20 to 25% more efficient. And it's also more stable to variation due to heat. You probably have seen bulbs like that already. And when you go to the hardware store, you might have some in your house, where when they're off, actually, they look yellow. When you turn them on, they emit white light. So these bulbs, basically, if you were to break them, you would see that inside there's a blue LED and there's a yellow coating of phosphor on the outside shell, and that's how they make a white light. At ChromaQ, we have a product called the Studio Force Phosphor V that uses this phosphor remote principle. But as always, we're always trying to find brilliant solutions. So we have added a clever system that also allows it to change color temperature as well as tint, the plus minus green. So you can adjust it for your application. So talking about managing color temperature now. So now we know that there's a variety of color temperature LEDs available. So how do we make a variable white light? Well, the answer is simple. We use two or more different type of temperature LEDs, and then we will combine them together. For example, we could have a warm white at 2800 Kelvin, and we could use a cold white at 6000 Kelvin. By varying the intensity between those two LEDs, we would be able to achieve a wide range of color temperature. So, another aspect of LED is, which is not light, it is thermal management. So one of the biggest misconceptions that we often hear in the LED world is that, well, LED doesn't produce any heat. And I bet you have heard this argument before. Well, actually, LEDs produce a lot of heat. And this is, but like most of the LED, the heat is not projected in forward like a tungsten bulb would do or an HID bulb would do. Instead, the heat will go at the back of the LED and typically will be dissipated through the circuit board for low-powered LEDs, or it will use some kind of a heat sink for the high-powered LEDs. So why does it matter? Well, heat is the biggest enemy of the LED. Too much heat will reduce the output, will affect the longevity of the LEDs, will alter its color, and will also make the source unstable. And some of the damage are irreversible. So that's managing the heat is really important. So proper cooling will make the fixture last longer, and also its color point will stay the same over time. The other important part is on the short time, on a short period of time. So if you turn on a fixture and you measure it, let's say you're doing a cinema scene and you turn on the fixture, you expect the fixture to be the same 15 minutes after and a half an hour later or 2 hours later. You don't want to have to go and readjust every once a while the set. So, and to do this, it's very important. You can have, if you have example, if your cooling is not consistent, then the fixture gets cold and gets warm, gets cold, gets warm, the LEDs will start shifting. So, and it will keep doing that all the time. So it's really important to keep the fixture at the same temperature all the time. So we spend a lot of time, of effort on that. Another way of doing it is basically by using fans, but then you have noise control. So if you have, if you're in a studio, you don't want to have any noise. So fans becomes a problem. So you, then you need to use heatsink, bigger heatsink. But by doing this, you will have more weight on the fixture. So it's always a trade-off between how you want the fixture to be, lighter, heavier, quieter. So all of this needs to be considered when the fixture is designed. And just to say that heat management is extremely important in a fixture. So great, now we've basically covered the most important part of a variable white light. So let's see which fixture we have and what we can do with them. And at Chroma Q, we have a wide range of products, but today we will be mainly talking about those white light fixtures that I have highlighted here on the screen. So let's start with this one here, the Studio One 100. It's a nice little PAR that is has a very flat and homogenic lens that looks very good on camera. And that's very important. Like, you don't want to have like pixelated things that on the camera. The Studio One 100 uses conventional cooling, so it is for silence operation, and it makes it perfect for studio, film, TV, exhibition, and even entertainment lighting. It is available in three variants. We have the tungsten, the daylight, and the variable. Next, very different fixture. It's a space light. It's called the Chroma Q Space Force. It's a variable white light as well. And it was designed to replace a 6 kilowatt tungsten space light, which is used in cinema and television, as well as many other applications where you need a bright variable white light. Based on that same principle as the original Space Force, we have the Space Force 1x2 now. It's a smaller footprint at 12 by 24 inches. It is lightweight at 14 pounds. It is ideal for lower ceiling studios. It is portable lighting, remote shooting, conference room, webcast studio, and many more applications. It's one of those fixtures that can be used pretty much anywhere. And then we have the bigger brother, the Space Force 2x4. It is a very bright fixture. It's four times as bright as the 1x2. It generates a whopping 55,000 lumens. It is ideal to light up studio site, green screen, blue screen. With no heat projected in the front, it can replace a 5K Fresnel in cinema and TV application and get much closer to the props and the cars and even talent without having them feeling the heat. Its form factor allows also to fit perfectly into a 2x4 ceiling tile. So it can, on a movie set or even TV set, it can replace traditional fluorescents with this fixture. And with 8 different cells or zones that can be controlled individually with intensity or color temperature, effects can be created as well as gradient, like daylight to sunlight. So the Space Force range can be adapted to many situations with its wide range of accessories. We have lantern, skirts, target with diffusion, different level of diffusion, egg crates to control the beam spread. We also have hanging devices from yoke to brittle and that are also available for these fixtures. So to give you some example, here we have the a studio that was done a few years ago in the UK, and that's a motion picture studio, and there's 144 space for us. If they have done this the traditional way with tungsten fixture, it would have been 864,000 watts of power. Using the Space Force, it's only 48,000. And if we look at the weight, it's not exactly half, but if we also consider all the cabling that would be needed to power up so many tungsten fixture, it is a big difference. And if we look at the output, that's where it gets quite interesting. While a 6 kilowatt fixture is really bright on its own, by the time you put all the skirts around it to diffuse it to make it suitable for the application in a cinema, for example, where you want to have like very soft shadows, it will lose a lot of its output. So it's not really efficient. The Space Force is naturally diffused to start with. And so you don't have this waste of energy right there. And actually, if you compare them on foot candle or LOX, it is 70% more efficient, more output basically on the Space Force than it would be on the tungsten fixture. Another application for Space Force is in the broadcast studio. And in this case here, it's used where in a studio where people move around from one spot to the other so they can light up the whole space equally, so wherever the person goes, it will always be illuminated properly. And of course, all the accent will be done with some key lights, but the overall studio is designed, is basically lit with Space Force. Another example is for commercial application, in this case, like doing movie video commercials, so where you want to have very soft light, so very good fixture for that. But also can be used for still photography. So in this case, this is a studio where they do pictures for a piece of art as well as other objects and clothing. And it needs to go really fast, so they don't have the time to set up the lighting for every shot. So instead, the photographer can move around the objects, take picture from different angles, and it's always perfectly lit. So that's a really good way of doing it. And here we have the Space Force used in a fashion show. It wasn't designed for that to start with, but here's a good, it turns out to be a very good usage for it. And what's interesting here is the set needs to be lit for three different things: still photography, video, and of course there's people in the room, and so it is pleasant to the eye. So in all cases, the fixture will produce really nice light. And of course, creative way of using Space Force. This was a play actually where they used the fixture on the stage. And here the fixture was used on a show as a piece of part of the set design basically. So it's another way that the fixture can be used. It can be quite interesting. So this covers the range of products that we have, the Wi-Fi that we have at ChromaQ. And so just so you know, next week we will be talking about color. So we will have basically how do they mix, how the binning works for LED, colored LED, how those luminaire comes together. So that would be quite an interesting one. So you can put that on your calendar. That will be on June 3rd at 3 o'clock. You need to register ahead of time for the events.
Yeah. Thank you, Paul. Very interesting. If I didn't make that clear to our audience, I see we have a good mix of English and French-speaking people. You can certainly write your questions in English as well. First question is, the text exceeds the image frame. That is true. The background is black, and so the text up top of the slides, and perhaps, Paul, you can stop sharing your screen, but basically that's just the way the slides are. Deuxième question est très bonne. Est-ce que ChromaQ va ou a développé des fixtures de type LICO à focus variable avec possibilité de sharpness? Leurs produits sont plus stables que certains autres fabricants et offrent une très belle qualité en général. C'est une excellente question. D'ailleurs, l'éclairage Space Force, on l'utilise dans notre studio Solotech que vous allez voir dans les prochains webinaires, justement. Donc, Paul?
Pour l'instant, c'est pas. On a d'autres produits en développement présentement. On n'a pas décidé encore de se lancer dans l'hélico. Évidemment, c'est un autre type de produit, c'est un autre type d'optique. Donc, ça demande d'autres ressources, on peut dire. Donc, pour l'instant, c'est pas quelque chose qu'on a regardé. Pas qu'on y a pas pensé, mais pour l'instant, c'est pas quelque chose qui est directement en développement. Mais si tu me demandes personnellement, oui, j'aimerais s'en faire.
Oh, c'est super. Si vous ne le savez pas, dans la partie chat, j'ai mis un hyperlien vers les enregistrements, l'horaire, et en fin de compte, les liens pour s'enregistrer au prochain webinaire. Donc, vous avez sûrement remarqué que ce webinaire-là est enregistré. Ils le sont tous. Les plus anciens sont sur notre site web et les futurs ont un lien pour s'enregistrer au prochain. On a présentement des sujets jusqu'au 24 juin. Donc, ça conclut notre présentation d'aujourd'hui. On est très bon à 26-27 minutes. Bravo. C'était super intéressant. Merci beaucoup, Paul. La semaine prochaine, on continue où on va parler des couleurs d'ailes ou les LED colors dans un monde plus pratique. Et on va le faire pour la première fois à partir des studios Solotech, dans lequel on fait la présentation. Mais le 10 juin, on va vous présenter les équipements dans notre studio Rémi de Solotech. Donc, merci de vous être joints à nous aujourd'hui, si nombreux. On apprécie énormément votre temps. Et à la prochaine, mercredi prochain, exceptionnellement, une heure plus tard, à 15h, heure avancée de l'Est. So, next week, we'll do a second part of this webinar. We'll do the same thing. It'll be a hybrid of French and English, very Canadian thing, I guess, multilingual, official languages. And we'll continue on this presentation. And for the first time, we'll actually do it from our new Solotech Studio, which is a Remy application that we've put together, which we'll talk about more on June 10th. And right now, if you go at the Q, not the Q&A, but the chat part, you'll see that actually we have a link towards our recordings of these webinars. You may have noticed that it is being recorded. You get to see all the former webinars. You get to see the schedule for future webinars. And you also have links to registers. So thanks again. Great seeing you. And we'll talk to you next week. Check this out.